All right, folks, let's take a seat. It's 8:31, and we'll get ready to get started. If I get a cue to go ahead and get started, that's okay? Yes? All right, good enough. Well, it is, good morning, everyone. I'm Peter Crino. I'm chair of the board of directors of the Tuberous Sclerosis Complex Alliance, and it is my extreme pleasure to welcome everyone to the 2022 World Conference. Let's give it up for the conference. We have a very distinguished panel of speakers today who are going to touch on some really, really exciting things that have been going on in the TSC world. And I think what's so exciting is that this meeting is indeed an international collaboration between TSC Alliance here in the States and TSC International. And the real focus of this meeting very much has been on the work that's going on in TANDem with the recent publications of the guidelines. So it's a very, very exciting time. And it really is amazing to get everyone together. As I was saying at the remarks last night, it's really incredible what an enormous family this is, and what has started out kind of regionally has now extended globally, and we do in fact have a global outreach. And it's, for those of you who are watching home virtually, welcome. We're so glad that you could join us. Obviously we miss you in person, but it's great that you're able to join. And the fact that we have everyone just internationally collaborating on this and working. We have so many fabulous minds. We have research funds and direction and infrastructure. So it's an incredibly exciting time in tuberous sclerosis complex research. I want to really extend a thank you from the TS Alliance and from TSI to our two sponsors. Our title sponsor is Jazz Pharmaceuticals, and our presenting sponsor is Noble Pharma, for making this conference possible. So I can get a round of applause for them. Thank you. Also, a very sincere thank you to Drs. Bonnie and Jonathan Rothberg for making the live streaming and all the technology possible, which is great, so we have folks who can join virtually. We had 30 additional sponsors, and we also had 20 clinics who sponsored the conference bags, and if you look on the conference bags, you can see them all delimited on the one side, which is really fantastic. What we're going to focus on this morning is so much work that's going on in TAND, Tuberous Sclerosis-Associated Neuropsychological Deficits, an acronym which really sums up sort of a complicated series of presentations of individuals with TSC. It includes intellectual disability and autism spectrum disorder, but just so much more. And we've come to understand so much in this space. And this really is, I think, a wonderful example of the sort of the partnership internationally as we're all beginning to address this. This is an unmet need in TSC research, and while we've made good strides in several other areas, this remains, I think, a centralized challenge for research and clinical care, and really just for patient family care in terms of the day-to-day. So, as I said, we have an incredible faculty of speakers here today, and it's my real privilege to introduce, in the spirit of bringing together our international community, the opening session's moderator, Dr. Pradnya Gadgil.
Thank you, Dr. Crino. Good morning, everyone. A very, very warm welcome. I'm Pradnya. I'm a clinic director in Mumbai, India. So I've come a long way to say hello to everyone. I'm very happy to be the moderator for today's session, which is about global collaborations, TANDem, and the updated consensus guidelines. I would also like to welcome everyone who's joining us on the live stream. So today's session is sponsored by Upshur Smith Laboratories. A little bit of housekeeping. After each session, we request you to fill in a survey for each session. For each survey you submit, you'll be entered into a daily prize-winning draw. Also, we will take questions at the end of the session. So if you have any while the talks are going on, please jot them down, and then we will take questions. So today's session, this morning session is a very important session because, yes, as Dr. Crino said, it showcases the impact that international collaborations have. So this session actually talks about two very important pieces. One is the consensus guidelines, and the other is the TANDem. As we all know, these actually provide us a blueprint to plan the ongoing care for TSC patients. So it's important for clinicians, yes, but it's also very important for families. So with that, I would like to call our first speaker, Ms. Eva Schoeters. She is a TSC mom. Her son, Pepine, got diagnosed with TSC in 2008. And she's an amazing crusader. She started the Rare Disease Organization and is a director for the Rare Diseases Organization in Belgium. Then she started the TSC Alliance in Belgium and chairs it. And she now also is part of TSC International and is on the TANDem Consortium. So let's hear Eva's story.
Hello, everybody. It feels pretty strange standing up here addressing you. Well, I was invited to address you about the life I live with my son, Pepin. But I know all of you out here have these extraordinary stories yourself, so it feels a bit strange to be telling mine to you. But since I've been invited to do so, I'm going to give it the best I have. And I just hope it will be of some use to you. How do I make this work? So here we are, Geert, my husband, and I, with our son, Pepin. He's had two periods of epilepsy in his life, but he's been seizure-free for about 5 years now. The MRIs on his brain and on his abdomen, his kidneys have been stable. They haven't caused us too much trouble so far, so we're really lucky. And with him on everolimus, we feel sort of, or we allow ourselves to feel secure in the belief that it might stay this way. We're very grateful for that. Pepin doesn't read or write, but he walks and he talks and he understands perfectly what's being said to him if you can get him interested enough to listen. So how hard can it be? In the first months after Pepin's birth, my husband and I used to stand over his cradle and say, oh, look at what a wonderful, perfect baby he is. From the first time we first unknowingly but consciously saw him having infantile spasms, he was 11 months by then. It took us and the doctors we consulted about 7 months to the realization that there was something seriously wrong, an experience I think a lot of people around here can relate to. And it took a month more to get them under control, which is pretty good, I guess. And then we got the diagnosis of tuberous sclerosis complex. He was 20 months by then. After the genetic analysis confirmed that he has a mutation on the TSC2 gene, some months later, we also learned he has the contiguous gene syndrome, meaning he has polycystic kidney disease. And after a developmental analysis, he was diagnosed with autism at the age of 2. And we had trouble believing that for quite a while, because he was all cuddles and smiles. I mean, the first time he smiled at us, he was 8 weeks, 6 weeks, no sign of autism to our minds. And the only thing we knew about autism was Rain Man, so it was a bit scary to hear this being said. Yeah. Apart from everolimus, he's taking blood pressure medication to protect his kidneys, anti-epilepsy drugs. I'm not going to go over them all. But since half a year, we have had added aripiprazole. I'm not used to using that word because we just call it Abilify, which is much easier, and it sort of covers what it does. It enables him, it makes him more able for a lot of things. So on these medications so easily mentioned, I'd like to point out that more's involved than popping the pill in the mouth, because Pepin refuses to swallow anything, and he's extremely sensitive to taste. So apart from the Depakine that he gets, every one of his medications is dissolved in water. It's prepared as a powder, and we go about a special system of administrating it to him with syringes or either mixed with yogurt. And it takes a lot of time explaining all that to the people apart from us taking care of him. And you have to trust that they're doing the right job, and sometimes just accidentally you hear that they are not, which is a bit scary sometimes too. So we really spoon his meds into him because he can't be trusted to eat the yogurt all by himself. and get it all down. And then another important fact is that he had slowly increasing trouble walking over the past years. Since he was about 7, I think, we thought he was just unwilling to walk, as he's unwilling to do a lot of things that we would like him to do. But it slowly dawned on us that he was really having trouble and that it caused him pain, and it was a big physical effort. So after some trial and error with support on his feet, he was operated on in the past year, in November in 2021, on both feet, quite a serious surgery. And, well, we hope this will prevent him from ending up in a wheelchair, because he wasn't able to walk 500 meters anymore without pain. I'm sorry, I don't know how much that is in miles or whatever, feet, but it's not much. I think it's slightly more than a third of a mile. So, there he is after his operation, and I must say he's been truly heroic about managing all the different stages that came with the operation, which was like 8 weeks of living, lying down and completely not standing up, being carried around for things. And yeah, he overcome so many fears to start walking again, and now he's walking around, I think, a mile now without too much trouble. And we're really proud of him having accomplished that, because given his mental characteristics, it's a big, big thing. So with him on Abilify, I'll keep to the easy name, life has become slightly less challenging for us, and I'd even say slightly less scary, because we're no longer at risk of him unhinging the doors if we want to get him to go anywhere, and he doesn't hit me as much when I try to wash him and get him clothed, which he doesn't do by himself. But he has still, he's a teenager, he's 13 and a half, I forgot to mention, and he swears and curses and uses bad language like a drunken sailor all the time, which is pretty embarrassing. So, yeah, I'm sorry, the pictures are not coming along as I planned them to, but, well, whatever. A couple of words on sleep, which might help explain why Papin has taken charge of our lives so completely, because his forceful charm and aggression are only a part of the explanation. With the birth of a baby, we all hope that he will sleep through the night soon enough, but it took us about 9 to 10 years to get to that stage, and now he still wakes us up at 5 a.m. every morning. And at first, you still foster the expectation that you will manage to continue on your job and have a social life and a happy marriage and all of that. You know, you're just alongside the lack of sleep and the care for the TSC. But soon my professional life, in any case, became one with huge gaps and frustrations. And our marriage has been challenged quite a number of times. My free time has been spent catching up on sleep so much more than I ever would have wished. And lack of sleep, however trivial it sounds, is hugely impactful. It changes your experience of everything, and it changes your capacity to think straight and to organize yourself, to take an interest in the world around you and to be sociable. And it also changes your capacity to handle challenging parenting situations in the best way. So, yeah, I think it's really important to think about sleep disorders also causing sleep disorders in parents and the effect that has. Due to his immense sensitivity to stimuli around in the world and his compulsive interests, it's a huge challenge to get him to enjoy any activities with other people, especially children. But he knows really well how to charm the people around him, the ones that are dear to him, with this repertoire of special things that he does to tease them and make jokes in a very specific way. And he sort of catches them in his realm and in his reality. He's played his magic on two boys as well in his group. But before I go into that and show them to you. I want to talk about the fact that he has sort of limited our family outings to visits to the underground, which is his great preference, and train stations and bus stations. We have spent hours and days and weeks at the busiest traffic places in our town just watching cars go by. And then he adds on this imaginary world of his, having us spotting minions, imaginary minions, on the trams. And when we went to London, we did not get to enter any shop, any museum. The only thing we did was actually get dragged back down to the underground all the time, which he loves so much. But I must say, we sort of passed that phase now, and I actually start to regret it, because he's so glued to his screens nowadays that we hardly get to leave the house. And I sort of miss the underground and the train station outings. So as you will have gathered, TAND is the main issue in our life. And we're grateful that apart from the, his compulsiveness and his aggression, because, I want to give you an honest story. It's not always a happy thing, and every day comes with ups and downs. But he does have this way of being so immensely sweet as well, as you can see in this picture of him with my husband. He has also the characteristics that the TSC Alliance has, being that he is extremely resilient, hopeful, forcefully hopeful, and strong, forcefully strong in getting his way all the time. And he's sort of made us into an extension of himself. He's also come to this compelling belief that I can make anything for him that he wants. Like what you see here, he orders me, he says, make me this or that aeroplane, and it has to be like this specific thing that he's seen in a game, and he just sucks me into doing it time and time again. So if I'm not asleep at the weekends, catching up on sleep, I'm usually either playing a game with him or making a boat, a plane, a train, whatever, in clay, in papier-mâché, in cardboard, whatever. Actually, I've grown to be quite proud of my collection, filling the cupboards. And then he plays with them for a little while, accompanied by his imperative YouTube films, which he acts out with all of this stuff. That's sort of our life with Pepin. This is him working his charms. And here are the two very special friends that make like a huge difference to us. The left one is a nephew of mine. He has normal capacities, and he has known Pepin from when he had his bad seizures, and we spent holidays together, and he's grown to accept and love him. And they really have fun together, but you can also feel that he takes care of Pepin, and he backs off when things get too bad, but he doesn't let it come interfere with this really tender friendship that they have. And then the other one on the right-hand side is someone in his school where he is now, and this school is a huge game changer for us. He's spending 3 nights a week there now, which is truly, it is giving me and my husband back our life a bit. And it feels really strange to say that about a 13-year-old, because he's our only child, and it means that, we're going towards a childless house already, which is not what you hope for when you have a child. But it is really important for us, and I think it's for the best for Pepin, because he does seem to be happy there and well surrounded and still very fragile. They're saying he's dangling down below at the, the level towards the other children, and they're already asking us if he's actually in the right place. So we are, it's so fragile to find the really right place for your child, because TSC is so specific, and every child with TSC is so specific, and you just don't fit into the boxes that are around, if they're around, if you're lucky enough to have them. So yeah, I'm going over time and I'm not keeping to what I was planning to tell you at all, but I do want to add just a couple of things before I hand over to these wonderful people here, which is that I was lucky enough to attend the TSC World Conference 4 years ago here with my husband then, and I just wanted to say how important the connection to the TSC community is for us and to TSCI, and how important the work of TSC Alliance is to so many more people around the globe than just the USA. So I really want to give my huge appreciation for your generosity and having us all along on this journey, on the global participants. One of the most important pillars in my peace of mind is the fact that I can feel assured that the medical follow-up in Belgium for us is organized by a TSC expert in the room here that does it according to the consensus guidelines, which are so immensely important. I mean, just knowing this relieves me of having to figure it all out. And we really cannot overemphasize the importance of the consensus guidelines. And TAN being so important in our family, I suppose you can imagine how big an honor it is to be the community speaker preceding these two people here who are so important for these two things. A final image, EURORDIS, Rare Diseases Europe, used this for World Happiness Day. And I was really touched because actually the day the picture was taken was not a happy one, but this was a happy moment where we managed to get Pepin to the beach for about half an hour. And I took this picture and it grabbed the happiness. And I think it's by cherishing the happy moments and with a lot of love that you manage all these huge waves that TSC splashes over you all throughout the day and all throughout your life. That's just wanted to conclude with. So thanks. And
thank you, Ima. That was an incredibly touching story. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. So next up, we have Dr. Hope Northrup. She's a director and professor of medical genetics at McGovern Medical School at UT Health in Houston. So in her words, her passion is her family, her husband Ed, her daughter who's going to become a child neurologist, and her son-in-law Travis and her son Daniel. So Dr. Hope Northrup has done legendary work in the field of TSC genetics. In 1987, she was part of the team which discovered the genes, then figured out what do these TSC genes do, how do they work, and that has helped us to understand how to actually treat patients with TSC. And of course, her favorite thing about TSC is all of you, the patients and families living with TSC. So today she's going to talk to us about the updated consensus guidelines.
Thank you. And thank you so much for the honor of being here. Eva, your story just is so moving. Thank you. And thank you for that kind introduction. So my charge today is to talk with you about the updates to the consensus conference guidelines. And just as a little bit of background, just to recall that the original TSC consensus conference was in 1998, and our main output from that conference was to further hone and refine diagnostic criteria that had been developed by Dr. Manuel R. Gomez. So in 2012, we all came together, 80 experts from 14 countries, to have a second consensus conference about tuberous sclerosis. And that conference went much further. In addition to looking at diagnostic criteria, we also looked at the genetic part because we really didn't know any of the genes in 1988. And most importantly, we laid out surveillance and management guidelines as a gold standard for us all to strive for to take care of tuberous sclerosis patients. Now, this is not to ignore the fact that these guidelines really cannot be met worldwide, and we know that. This is an aspirational goal, and what we would like to see for all our tuberous sclerosis patients that we have not met yet, and I want to emphasize the word yet. We will eventually someday meet those goals. So after the guidelines were published from 2012, we were going to be having the TSC World Conference here in Dallas in July of 2018. And so the TSC Alliance said, well, maybe we need to look and see if there are any updates, because it's been close to 5 years when they started talking with us about doing these updates. And so the original committees, chairs, and co-chairs were contacted, gathered together, and back then, to do our pre-work, we didn't have WebEx and Zoom and all those great things. This is 2018, 2017, so we talked by the old-fashioned system of the telephone and emails and so forth. And so we did a pre-work, and then we came together here 4 years ago to make these updates. And the output of that meeting was published last year in a journal, Pediatric Neurology. And the editor is Dr. Steve Roach, a longtime supporter of the TSC community, a child neurologist. And he was able to make the article that has all of the information from the updates freely publicly available at no charge. So today I'm going to talk about some highlights, but keep in mind that you can have access to the entire article if you wish to see more details. So first, let's get the diagnostic criteria out of the way. Why do we want diagnostic criteria in the first place? We want to rapidly diagnose people who have tuberous sclerosis and then try to determine the extent of the phenotype. What are the different findings that we can see in people who have tuberous sclerosis, and what should we do about them? And we need to constantly update these criteria. Okay, so this is basically what it boils down to for diagnostic criteria. In order to make a clinical diagnosis of tuberous sclerosis, you need to meet either two of the major features on the left, or a major feature on the left and one or more minor features on the right for a definite diagnosis. And for a possible diagnosis, you need one major or one or more minor features. And the only changes we made in 2018 are on the left-hand side. You can see we struck through the term cortical dysplasias to describe the brain findings on imaging in tuberous sclerosis. We wanted to make it much more specific to the exact things that we see in the brains of people who have tuberous sclerosis. And on the right side, we previously had six minor criteria, and we added back a seventh, which was sclerotic bone lesions. We see these bone lesions in people with tuberous sclerosis when we get chest CTs, abdominal imaging, and unfortunately people didn't recognize this as being part of the disease, and some of those patients were being referred as possibly having metastatic cancer. And this is a very specific finding to tuberous sclerosis, so we added it back. We continued to say that a pathogenic variant in TSC1 or TSC2 does make the diagnosis. Recognizing that there are people who have one of those genetic changes who would not meet clinical diagnostic criteria, but we still need to follow those people. They can develop other findings over time. We need to take care of them and make sure that if that happens, we find them. And we also wanted to acknowledge in the article that we had more tools in our toolbox, that genetic testing had advanced even in the short 5-year time frame since the previous meeting. So, big picture items that we really wanted to emphasize were that we're going to have newly diagnosed criteria in a table, and we were going to have a table for those who we know have tuberous sclerosis that we're following. I'm going to only highlight one or two findings per organ system in the rest of the talk. I'm going to map also to the other sessions in the meeting about the different organ systems, so that if you have a specific interest in something that I mentioned today, or you have a specific finding that you want to talk about, you'll know which other sessions you might want to attend. And finally, I'm going to talk nothing about TAND. My colleague, Dr. Petrus de Vries, is going to speak next and talk about all things TAND. That doesn't mean TAND wasn't included in the updated document. It certainly is, but he's going to illuminate all of that information for us. So big picture. First big picture, a big emphasis on early EEG screening. The recommendation now is in a child who's diagnosed with tuberous sclerosis who's under a year of age, we get EEGs every 6 weeks. And between ages 1 and 2, we get an EEG every 3 months. Because we know that EEG findings can be a precursor to seizures, and we want to find them as soon as possible. There was also a big emphasis in the updates on TAND, and Petrus will talk about that. And I'm going to highlight some of the medication approvals that occurred between the two times that we were able to meet and talk about findings. So I've already talked about genetics. There are 3 sessions in genetics here at the conference, 2 today and 1 on Saturday. Some of those are more focused on the actual genetics, genetics made simple, and others have genetics as part of the picture of what we're going to talk about. So first, the brain, and I'm going to focus on tumors first. There were 2 different panels, 1 on tumors and 1 on seizures involving the brain in the consensus conferences. And we recommend that the gold standard would be to get a brain MRI at diagnosis and then to follow up every 1 to 3 years as indicated by findings. Up until age 25, when if an individual does not have a SEGA, we do not need to be as concerned about developing one, and that after 25, brain imaging, if you do not have a SEGA, would really be if you have findings that we need to image you immediately. Whenever anyone with tuberous sclerosis has brain findings, we need to image them. And finally, if a person has a SEGA and they have acute deterioration, they need surgery immediately. If a person has a SEGA that is large or enlarging, they can choose between surgery and an mTOR inhibitor working with their team. But knowing that if you use an mTOR inhibitor, that's also going to affect all your other findings of tuberous sclerosis. And there's a panel this afternoon on brain tumors. So the brain and seizures, another extremely important area. Again, we recommended these routine EEGs much more frequently than in the past, knowing what we know. And vigabatrin is recommended as our first line for infantile spasms. If it doesn't show efficacy in about 2 weeks, we want to then try ACTH and prednisolone. But for other seizures of tuberous sclerosis, use usual recommended anti-epileptic drugs. Drugs that had been approved since that time included an mTOR inhibitor, everolimus, which is good in refractory epilepsy and tuberous sclerosis. Also, a cannabidiol formulation had been approved again for seizures in tuberous sclerosis and could be another good therapy for those. Finally, epilepsy surgery should be considered sooner rather than later, particularly in a child who's showing regression and after someone has failed 3 different anti-epileptics. And because seizures are so important, there are 6 different sessions on seizures, 3 today that are competing for your attention, depending on what aspect of seizures you have more questions about. And then 3 more on Saturday that are at different times that you may want to attend one or the other, depending on particular issues you're facing, like refractory epilepsy, for example. For the kidneys, we recommend as the gold standard abdominal MRI every 1 to 3 years, an annual assessment with urinalysis, blood pressure, and GFR. If there's an acute hemorrhage from an angiomyolipoma, we need to have embolization followed by corticosteroids. If there's an asymptomatic but growing angiomyolipoma of 3 centimeters or greater, we need to start an mTOR inhibitor, and that is considered the first-line therapy. Surgery and ablation are not as effective in mTOR inhibitors because we want to preserve the kidneys as much as we possibly can. The old therapy of taking a whole kidney out because you have large angiomyolipomas is not a good idea, because even with large angiomyolipomas, you still have some good kidney tissue there, and the longer you can preserve your renal function, the longer you'll be able to put off something like having dialysis, needing a transplant. And there are two sessions on the kidneys on Saturday at different times. So if you have a lot of kidney issues coming up, these would be good to attend. One is about tumors and cysts and treatment options, and the other one's about managing progressive kidney disease. The lung, the pulmonary team, the lung team, they worked very hard in their updates. And they have some very good information that's included in the document. I've tried to narrow it down to what I'm showing you here as sort of the essence of recommendations. First of all, you need to get a CT scan in any tuberous sclerosis patient who's having pulmonary issues who you think may have a finding related to tuberous sclerosis. But if the patients are asymptomatic, you need to start imaging females at 18 years of age with a chest CT. If that chest CT shows findings, you need to refer them to a pulmonary specialist who knows about LAM. If the chest CT doesn't show any findings and is good, then you can continue to follow every 5 to 7 years with repeat imaging until menopause. Use of mTOR inhibitors as therapy for LAM is very important. And you can see here that there are a number of different indications that would trigger the use of an mTOR inhibitor in a patient who has LAM. Things like increased disease burden indicated, abnormal lung function, all sorts of different findings that we can see that the pulmonary specialist would recognize. Finally, patients who have tuberous sclerosis need to be counseled about certain exposures, medications, and also pregnancy in females, because we know that exposure to certain medicines can cause problems, as well as exposure to tobacco use and so forth. And there's a lung session later today on treatment options and clinical trials. I put skin and teeth together because they really do go together in my mind, and there is a session later today on some skin and teeth issues that you can attend and find out more. Annual skin exams are recommended for children, and for adults, the skin exams are recommended depending on findings. It's also really important to talk about sun exposure, because we've learned through some wonderful, elegant studies done by TSC doctors and scientists that sun exposure will cause a second genetic hit in cells of your skin that can lead to the facial angiofibromas increasing in size and number. We know that everyone should avoid the sun because of skin cancer, but it's especially important with people with tuberous sclerosis. We also have learned in the interim that treating skin lesions, either flat or minimally raised lesions, we can use topical mTOR inhibitors, and a number are available for us, either compounded locally or through various available medications. If those don't work, other options for the recalcitrant skin facial lesions would be laser therapies and also surgeries to work on those. For the dental, we need to examine the teeth every 6 months and get a panoramic once a year. We know that if you have problems with cysts or you have problems with gum fibromas, you may need to have surgeries for those or curettage. As I mentioned, there's a session later today on skin and dental manifestations. And then finally, the other organs, and I've just put those into one slide because there's only one session that encompasses these other organs. So the heart, eyes, liver, and pancreas, we know we can have findings of tuberous sclerosis in every organ and including those organs. In the heart of a child, we need to get an echocardiogram at baseline and then follow up if there are cardiac rhabdomyomas to make sure those are regressing and disappearing. About every 1 to 3 years is the recommendation. If a child has had problems due to the cardiac rhabdomyomas, we need to get those more frequently. We also need ECGs every 3 to 5 years in people of all ages who have tuberous sclerosis because of concerns about conduction abnormalities. For the eyes, we need initial examination, and if we see astrocytic hamartomas that are there, those need to be followed. And it has been shown promisingly that we can use mTOR inhibitors if you have an astrocytic hamartoma in your eye and it is starting to cause a problem with vision. mTOR inhibitors have been shown to be efficacious and allow those to decrease in size. Finally, children on vigabatrin do need eye exams because we know that there can be side effects involving vision with vigabatrin. I will hasten to say, however, that we have now learned that those side effects are much less than we originally thought. And so vigabatrin is very safe and very good to be used in infantile spasms. And then the eyes need to be followed, but that's not nearly as severe a concern as we thought before. And finally, we have something called pediatric neuroendocrine tumors, or PNETs, that we can see in patients with tuberous sclerosis. And these tumors need to be referred to an endocrinologist for follow-up because we need to make sure that nothing bad happens because you have one of these tumors. And the decision as to whether or not to remove one of these tumors needs to be made under the healthcare provider's guidance. And there's a panel for these other manifestations on Sunday, and I think that that will be a very good panel if you have questions about the eyes, liver, pancreas, heart. There will be specialists there who can help you with those. And at that, I'm going to stop and say that I'm going to turn it back over to Pradnya. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Northrup. Now I would like to invite Professor Petrus de Vries. He's a professor in child and adolescent psychiatry and the founding director of the Center for Autism Research in Cape Town in South Africa. He has done extensive research in TSC and its associated neuropsychiatric disorders, what we all now call as TAND. He was a lead author in developing the TAND checklist and now is leading the TANDem Project. So let's hear all about TAND from Professor de Vries.
Right, I'm slightly taller than Hope. I'm just going to make them go up a fraction. Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Pradnya, and thank you, Eva and Hope, for your setting the scene. This is the introductory kind of first session. So what we thought to do was really just to lay the big picture groundwork for you to then go away into the rest of the conference to learn whatever it is that's relevant to you. So I, in the spirit of the overall theme of the conference, I decided to call my presentation TAND and the Power of Global Collaborations. And I have two key messages, and I'll give them to you now before you fall asleep. The first is that for something as complicated as TAND, the only way we're going to make progress and really have an impact globally is by working with people across different parts of the world and across different countries and across different disciplines, psychology, psychiatry, education, speech and language, occupational therapy, all sorts of other people. That's message number one, because there's no single country or single professional group that'll be able to figure out the needs of families and people who live with TSC and TAND. The second and even more important message is the only way we're going to make sure that we meet the needs of you, of people who live with TSC and TAND, is to work in partnership with you in all our endeavors. And by that, I don't mean we should talk to you and then go away and do research. I mean, you need to be part of all the different steps of planning, executing, writing up, reviewing, writing grants, etc., in order to make sure that we do what you need and not what we might think is a good idea. So those are the two messages. Now you can fall asleep, that's fine. For those who are still awake, I will continue. And how does this thing work? Is it the green big button? There you go. And I'm going to try to demonstrate these principles by introducing you to two groups of people. And this is a picture of the first group of people called the TANDem team or the TAND consortium. And I'll tell you more about TANDem in a minute, but you will see many of these faces at this conference. There in the middle behind me is Eva, who've just spoken, and next to her is Professor Anna Janssen from Belgium. Many American colleagues, people from all over the world. In fact, 10 different countries are represented in this study. And what I wanted to say about this picture is we actually have a table just outside the room. So if any of you during the meeting want to come and chat to us or get copies of the TAND checklist or look at some of the papers or take a selfie and post it. If you do that, you will get a free pin, right? So this might be bribery, but please come, take a picture, chat to us, because we want you to feel part of this project and part of this process. So that's the TAND consortium, or the TANDem team. I have four keywords that I want us to talk about today. And I know some of you are very regular attendees of this meeting. I've been to, this is my fifth. I know there are people who've been to all six. I missed the first one. I wasn't born yet. But so just to give me a sense of how you are in the room, I want to just get you to put up your hands and give me a general sense, just so that I know how much detail we should talk about. So how many of you feel you're pretty comfortable with what TAND is and what it means? Okay, yeah, pretty good, thank you. How many of you feel fairly confident about the different TAND levels and how we differentiate between them? Not too many, okay. How many of you are confident about what TAND clusters are and how they are different from TAND levels? Oh, we have a few experts here. Mm-hmm, good. And how many of you are fairly confident about and know about the TANDem project? Okay, all right. So I'm going to ask you at the end and see if you know more than at the moment, just to make sure. Right. So let's get going. TAND, the concept. As you've heard, it's called TSC-associated neuropsychiatric disorders. But many, and it's very much an umbrella term, that's why we use the very obvious umbrella to describe that. But many people ask us why we decided to come up with this term, TAND. And there were three main reasons, really. The first is we knew through research, through clinical practice, by talking to families, that most people with TSC at some point in their life will have some difficulties in some of their developmental, mental health, learning, school, work, relationship issues. And it was such a common thing, pretty much everyone. Different extents, different types, but most people have it. The second thing we realized was that very few people actually ever received any diagnosis and treatment or identification and support for these challenges. And that was really strange. Most people have it, but most people don't get anything. And so we were worried about what we can do to make that a bit better. And the third interesting realization was that there was a lot of confusion in the TSC community around the world about terms that people were using, about the language people were using to talk about these kinds of things. Let me illustrate that to you. So on the screen, you will see lots of different words that all have to do with TAND, and I'm sure you hear them and have used them at different times. Cognition, cognitive behavioral, neuropsychological, neurocognitive, mental health, neurodevelopmental. You can see different people use different terms. In different parts of the world, in different professional groups, people use the same word to mean different things, or different words to mean the same thing. And as a community, we felt this is actually a barrier to helping people speak the same language and do research in a way that will be clear about all the different aspects of why and what we then decided to call TAND. And so that's why we made up this TAND umbrella, and that's why we are talking about the six different levels of TAND. And what I'll do in this umbrella, I will quickly just talk you through each of those six different levels. See, now you already know more about the different levels. There's six of them. And I will just explain to you what we mean by it and list some of the key challenges. And you can, as you're sitting there, think, okay, yes, I have some of these. No, I don't. Yes, I might have. No, I don't. So let's start. The first level is what we call the behavioral level. For those who want to take a picture, the best time to take a picture is at the end. Because it comes like that, right? Okay. Just to help you not have 22 pictures. So, the behavioral level is simply referring to things we observe. You will see your child, you will feel yourself have, and these are some of the common things. Aggression. Listen to ever story. Temper tantrums, anxiety, depressed moods, self-injurious behavior, impulsivity, hyperactive behaviors, delaying language development, eye contact difficulties, repetitive behaviors, sleep problems. These are the common things we see. They are not diseases or disorders. They are things we observe, and when we observe them, we want to think, what do they mean? And then, what do we do about them? So that's what the behavioral level is, okay? It's simply a description of what we see. And these are important things because you will know what you experience in your own lives. The second level is what we call the psychiatric level. This is where we're now going to say, I need to ask an expert, somebody who's an expert in these kinds of things, to say, do I have enough of these symptoms for long enough to the exclusion of other things to say I have a particular diagnosis or disorder? And there are four that are, these are the most common ones that people with TSC are diagnosed with. The first is autism and autism spectrum disorders, very common in many people with TSC. And those who don't have autism might still have many of these behavioral characteristics at that behavioral level of having social communication problems and language issues and how to get on with other people issues. You can see the difference between the behavioral level and the psychiatric level, right? ADHD, very common in many people. So these are the two neurodevelopmental disorders that we very commonly see. Anxiety disorders, depressive disorders, particularly in teenagers, young adults, into adulthood, are the two main diagnoses that we see in people with TSC. The third level is the intellectual level. So, assessed through IQ type tests, all of us have intellectual abilities at some point. Some people are incredibly able, some people struggle. In TSC, about half of people have completely normal intellectual abilities. And the other half have some degree of intellectual developmental difficulties. And so we sometimes call it intellectual disability of different degrees. Characteristic in TSC is that most people have very uneven profiles of overall brain skills. And that's sometimes confusing. So you or your child or family member might have some things that are really good and some things that are really bad. And then people get confused and they say, but he's so good at that, why does he struggle with that? So that's characteristic. Even people with completely normal intellectual ability often have this uneven profile. I'm good at this, but I really struggle with that particular skill. So that's the intellectual level. Different from this level, but closely linked, is the academic level. This is when we're talking about school stuff, reading, writing, spelling, maths. And yes, most people with TSC who have some intellectual developmental problems struggle with, of course, with reading, writing, spelling, maths. But the key thing in TSC is that many children, even if they have completely normal intellectual abilities, have significant specific difficulties in school. And the most common is with mathematics. Anyone here who struggles with maths or struggled with maths? Yes. Okay. So that's why it's useful to know these are the common things in TSC because they're part of this TAND phenomenon. The fifth level is the one that people are sometimes the most confused about, and we call it the neuropsychological level. Our brains develop and do particular jobs in particular parts, and so these are brain-specific skills. And I've listed here on this picture just some of the most common things. If we had time, we don't have a long time today, I would have made you do all sorts of games and puzzles with me to figure out your brain skills. But some things, and again, the message here is many people with TSC, even if they have completely normal intellectual abilities, have specific difficulties in sustaining their attention. You might be sitting here really struggling to keep focusing on what I'm talking about, or you might zone in and zone out. It's common in TSC. Doing two things at the same time, dual tasking, is probably the most common difficulty for people with TSC. Having difficulties being flexible cognitively. We all get rigid and stuck at some point. In TSC, it's very common for many people really to struggle with being flexible in their kind of thinking and in their behavior, etc. So you can see, it's important for people to know these things are common because then we know we should look for them, and I'll come back to what we might do about them in a minute. The sixth level, which we wanted to add, And it makes perfect sense. You've listened to Eva's presentation. Yes, she's now taking the picture. Excellent. Is the psychosocial level. This is where we are talking about the impact of TSC on people's lives and on the lives of those with TSC and of the lives of those who are supporting people with TSC. Because people forget that it's not about just all the symptoms and signs, it's about how we live a life with TSC and the impact of that on our relationships, on our stress, on our friendships, on our ability to go to work, and all these kinds of things. So there you have it, the six levels of TAND. We made up this TAND checklist, there are copies of them outside. We've translated them now into, I think, 21 languages so far. We've put some Spanish copies and English copies outside for those who are interested. And having done all of that, now I'm going to introduce you to the second group of people who I think illustrate this message of global collaboration. And this is called, they're called Tuberous Sclerosis International. We took a new picture yesterday, so we all look much younger in that photograph. But TSCI is a community of people from all over the world, different professional groups, people with TSC, family members of people with TSC, and we all work together to try and identify the needs and come up with actions for people with TSC. And so all our TSC work and TAND research and work has been done with TSCI. And so having done all these things about TAND, levels, the checklist, we took the information to TSCI and said to them, well, what do you think? What's the challenge now? And people said, we like the checklist, we like the levels, but what's really difficult is everyone has such a unique profile. Everyone with TSC is different. Eva talked about Papin's uniqueness. And on the one hand, that's good because we are all unique. We are all individuals with our own strengths and weaknesses and quirks. But on the other hand, what it did, it made it very difficult for people to get access to any diagnosis or care. Because clinicians and physicians said, well, you're so unique, I don't know. And that was problematic. And so this lady here in the middle, I'll show you the picture, Lauren Leclesio, who was part of TSCI, and she was my PhD student at the time, said, well, we know that with our kind of clinical eyes, we can't see particular patterns because people are unique. But maybe we can use computer-based techniques, data strategies. You've all heard about big data, these kind of things. Maybe we can use those techniques to identify some natural ways in which all these TSC, these TAN things group. And maybe if we can find fewer groups, it'll make it easier for us to identify, to come up with tips, to come up with interventions and strategies. And that's exactly what Lauren then did. She took the TAN checklist items. Here on the screen, you can just see some of the behavioral items and a few other domains. She used all sorts of fancy computerized techniques, firstly in a little study, then in a slightly bigger one, and then in a large study of almost 500 people. And here you can, I wanted to show this because you can also see even the names of the participating sites were international. We had Steve Sparagana here from Dallas, not Fort Worth, I learned last night. People from Europe, people from all over. Because that allows us to bring together information of people from many different parts. And Lauren found, using those approaches, that we can find seven natural clusters, seven natural groupings of these TAND phenomena for people with TSC. At the bottom right, you can see there's this scholastic group of difficulties that we mentioned. Just above it, there's overactive, impulsive kinds of clustering behaviors that you might see. And think of you or your child might have some of those. Right at the bottom, mood and anxiety really clusters together, and shyness and those sorts of phenomena. Above it, eating, sleeping difficulties, very common, cluster together. Temper tantrums, aggression, we call them dysregulated behaviors, a very common cluster of difficulties and very difficult for many families. At the top, those neuropsychological things, the memory, the attentional, etc. And then the big messy one in the middle is an autism-related cluster. So many people with TSC have these autism-related things, and you can see it's in the middle because when you have autism-related stuff, you often have things in other clusters too. So it can be quite a tricky way. And so we took those ideas back to TSCI and said to them, haven't we done a good thing? And they went, yeah, that's all right. But we're still struggling to get our clinicians and physicians to fill in the TAN checklist for us. Can you make one that we can fill in ourselves? And can you make one that we can quantify and say how much of a problem it is, so that we can say, is it getting worse or is it getting better? Number two, while you're doing that, can you put it in an app for us so that we can fill in this thing online? And we are tired of just being told what the problems are. Can you give us some tips and tricks and ideas of what we can do about these challenges? Can you give us a toolkit somehow that's linked to that? And that was the reason and the background to the TANDem Project. Because in the TANDem Project, in fact, let me go back, funded by Belgian Royal Foundation, the Tuberous Sclerosis Association in the UK, generously supported by the TSC Alliance in all sorts of visible and invisible ways, we have three aims. The first is to make a self-report checklist that's quantified, to build it into an app, and then to make sure that it's valid against other data and that it's acceptable to you guys in the community. Number two, to generate consensus recommendations of what things people can do for identification and for support or treatment of TAN. And number three, we know we also need to build a much larger TAN community of researchers, of clinicians, of experts, because the needs are so vast around the world. And so what I'm going to do is just tell you a little bit about those three aims, where we're at, what we're doing, and what our plans are. Firstly, this picture of the TAN consortium, of the team. We have lots of different groups and teams, but the important one for you to see there in the bottom in purple, almost matching the purple of the TS Alliance team today, are family representatives. We have in the team people who have TSC, people who have family members of TSC. They are researchers in the team. They help us with each step. They write papers with us. They are on the papers with us. We pay for them to come to meetings, etc. So they are active participants in our research. And that's a really important thing. That's called true participatory research. With a TANDESQ, we've now developed a first version of the TANDESQ. We've built it into an app, and we are now going to validate it using families from Boston. So if you're with the Sahin team, or from Cincinnati, if you're with Darcy Kruger's team, and you've been in their previous research, you will be contacted to say, would you like to download the app, fill it in, and then we're going to see if it's meaningful to you. We're also using the TSC Alliance Natural History Database portal. So if any of you are in the TSC Alliance Natural History Database, you will be able to fill in the TAN checklist through the portal, and then we can link it to your natural history data. I think at the moment the priority is for people already in it, but I don't think the TSC Alliance would mind more people who might want to be interested to join the Natural History Database overall. So there, Kari, have I deserved my $10 payment there for the plug? There we go. So this is just to give you a sense of what the app will look like. You'll have like a landing page, you will log in, you will fill in some information about your TSC story or the people you want to fill in about. Then you can fill in the TAN checklist, and at the end of it, it will show you your clusters, the numbers, the percentage, which one are more prominent, and will allow you to prioritize what the things are that you want to work on. Aim two is these consensus guidelines. There aren't many actual studies that have been done in TSC to say, this is what you should do for TAN. So we had to use a consensus-building approach with experts. And we've looked at the literature, so if you come to and look at our poster, there's some papers of the what we've done so far. We worked in little cluster groups, and we also met as a consensus group. In fact, let me show you. You might not be able to read it from the back, but it was a long process where we got all the data, people looked at it in teams, they presented to everyone, we voted, they went back and revised it, we identified key principles, we voted on it. So it was a long process. And after that whole process, this is what we came up with. Three words. Now that might sound a bit strange, you all look a little bit stunned, but these are three really important words. Screen, act, repeat. Screen, because everyone with TSC is at risk of TAND, and we're saying you should screen for TAND at least once a year. Okay? Then once you've been screened, if you pick up anything that's problematic, act. Get people to do something. We've heard of too many families who have filled in TAND checklists and it's in the file, but no one's ever looked at them or done anything about it. Filling in a TAND checklist is not an intervention. It's the start of the acting, okay? So that's why we really wanted to put that act piece in there. And then, because we know that TAND manifestations can come on across the lifetime at different points, you need to keep doing it, at least once a year. Keep checking. If new things come online, think what you can do about them. To be fair, we do have more detail in our consensus paper that we're gonna write. So this is just a picture of that. We will have some core principles, and I'll show them to you in a minute. We will also have cluster-specific recommendations. And then one of the main themes that emerged was around the psychosocial challenges for families. And so we're calling it a wraparound. Around all those TAND difficulties, we need to think about what we can do in terms of supporting families. We're now starting the process where we're going to build the toolkit, all the information from people, into the app so that at the end, once you've filled it in, you've got your clusters, you can look at what you can do. There'll be a little movie general, then there will be a section on what you can seek, so that's which specialists, diagnoses, etc. But there will also be a section on what you can do yourself at home. Because we know many people may not have easy access to those specialists, particularly if you live in parts of the world such as Pradnya and I. So that'll give you a sense of what will be in the toolkit. But let me then just go back and just in the last few minutes, not many minutes, but I will just want to touch on some, tell you about some of the findings, just to give you a sense of what you will see. Hopefully before the end of this year, we will be able to publish these recommendations. The core principles that we're going to try and ask clinicians, physicians, and everyone around the world to do is to say everyone with TSC is at risk of TAND. Everyone, therefore, needs lifelong monitoring. It's not a one-off thing. Screen at least once a year, follow up with actions. The goal, we may not be able to prevent these things, but we want to catch them as early as we can, and we want to intervene as early as we can. I've already shown you clusters together. So if you have issues in the one, think about and look whether there might be challenges in some of the other clusters too. Always remember the impact of physical health challenges in TSC on TAND, not just the problems, but also the medications for some of the physical health challenges on TAND, because sometimes people forget to look at that link. Make sure you generate a biopsychosocial whole picture approach. There's never just, rarely just one thing you can do to improve a particular piece of TAND. There are often some biological things we might need to do. There are some psychological things we might need to do. There might be social and environmental things. And we need to think, what's the best approach now for you and your family? Be evidence-based and evidence-informed. We don't want people to come up with all sorts of random quacky things. So we are saying, use what's based, what's in the evidence, and let's generate more evidence that's TSC-specific as well. And then the last one is, it's not just about making symptoms go away. It's about making people have good quality lives, those with TSC, and good quality lives for families who live with TSC. And that's defined differently for different people at different times as well. But that really needs to be the emphasis for all of us. Very briefly, in the autism cluster, couple of examples of some of the recommendations we're recommending. Naturalistic developmental behavioral interventions is a big word. There will be a session on autism and autism interventions at the meeting. When you see a little logo at the bottom, it means there are sessions here. But we also try to put recommendations for adults, not just for children. So for instance, it's never too late. Even adults with TSC who have autism-like difficulties can benefit from social skills and other programs or plans that we use in the autism community. In dysregulated behaviors, one of the key messages is we need to understand the meaning, the function. We shouldn't just say he's aggressive, giving medications to make the aggression go away. We need to say what drives the aggression, what explains those things. And we need to use intellectual and neuropsychological evaluations to help us understand that. Eating, sleeping. Again, the point here, sleep problems might be a cause of TAND. It is a TAND, but it might also be a cause of other TAND difficulties. You heard Eva say when Papin doesn't sleep, nobody sleeps, and you can't concentrate and focus the next day. That's an example where sleep is the cause, but sleep can also be a consequence of, for instance, let's say you have a depressive disorder that might make you wake up. Let's say you have other kinds of challenges that might be the cause. Similarly, eating difficulties can either be caused by TAND-related or physical health problems in TSC. So actually it's very under-researched, but there are many people who describe issues with eating and feeding in TSC. And so we really want to put the spotlight on those. Mood and anxiety, I mentioned it, but it's highly underdiagnosed and undertreated, actually in everyone, but particularly in people who have co-occurring intellectual or developmental disabilities and autism, etc. People miss it. They see it, but they don't think of it. And we're saying the treatments that are available outside TSC should be used for people in TSC because we know that it can make a difference. The neuropsychological cluster, all those brain skills, they are very common, even in people with completely normal intellectual abilities, and they can have a profound impact on your life. People get overwhelmed. People makes them struggle in their jobs. It makes them become aggressive or anxious. It makes them withdraw from relationships because of those brain skills that they have. And there are things we can do to improve those brain skills. So that's why we really wanted to emphasize this as well. Overactive impulsive cluster. Whenever you or your child has some of these overactive impulsive things, you should consider a diagnosis of ADHD. It's also very underdiagnosed. And then we're saying, if you have ADHD, even if you have epilepsy and autism and intellectual disability and other medications, the kinds of treatments for ADHD might still be helpful for people with TSC. Often people are scared to think about those in TSC. Scholastically, school-aged children should be supported. There are some very nice sessions on school and education here. Jennifer Flynn, I don't know if Jen is here, who's in the TANDem team, and others are doing some sessions. And educators should really play a role to monitor the TAND manifestations of kids, to think, how do we help them access education and learning? And of course, scholastic classes, even though when we leave school, can still have an impact on our lives, on our occupation and work. So for those of you who are adults with some of these challenges, it's still important to remember. The wraparound psychosocial cluster, monitor the psychosocial functioning of all family members who live with TSC. Often we forget of mum and dad and brothers and sisters and aunties and uncles and grannies. We want to think about the child, the person, in the context of a family, and we want to look after the whole group of people. And then we want to make sure that we care for caregivers, because unless we care for you, you're not going to be able to do the rest of the job. And in fact, we're working very actively on thinking, finding strategies and techniques to do that. So the take-home message is screen at repeat, but then think what biological, what psychological, what social interventions should we use and can we use that will be helpful to everyone. So quickly, my time is up. The TAND Consortium is an international team of people, but we don't want to be thought of as an exclusive club, and we want it to grow, and we want you to become part of it. So if people are interested in what we do, particularly professional colleagues or others who want to think about and talk to us about next steps, please come and join us. One of the key things that we want is to build a next generation. So apologies for my obvious big TAND umbrella and little baby umbrellas, but we want to build little baby umbrellas. And we actually had a little mini symposium of people from different countries, 60 participants, talking about different aspects, preclinical, clinical, implementation, and interventional research, because that's the goal of what we're trying to do. We also, with the TSA, had a small seed grant round this year, and we had 7 applications from 6 countries, and we've just awarded 3 to people from 3 different countries. So trying to encourage and trying to find and build new research around the world. So many people are part of these kinds of things, but I hope that I've been able to illustrate to you just how important the power is of global collaboration and working together in order to improve the lives of people with TAND and TSC. And that's why I think this really fits beautifully with this kind of hopeful, relentless, strong, together theme of CARI, because I think that's the only way we can really shift the dial, as you like to say, on TAND. Final quiz. Are you feeling better about knowing about TAND? Yeah? TAND levels? TAND clusters? TANDem? Okay, so now here's the last question. What year was the term TAND coined? Was it 1880, 1980, 2002, 2012, or 2022? Very good, 2012. So, if you're good mathematicians, you will therefore know that TAND is 10 years old. So, before we end, you all have to join me and sing Happy Birthday to TAND. Are you ready? One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear TAND. Happy birthday to you. Yeah, excellent. I wasn't expecting the music, but thank you, whoever did that. So with that, I'm going to say thank you very much. I really hope you will all have a wonderful and inspiring conference. And please come and join all the TAND activities and sessions and come and talk to us. Thank you, Pradnya.
Oh boy, do we not know everything about TAND and TANDem now? So now we have 15 minutes, and the floor is open for questions. The microphone's up here. So if anybody has burning questions, you have, like Eva said, you have really people who've made this happen, people who've written the consensus guidelines, have designed a TAN, eager to answer your questions. Yes, please.
This is a, there it is. This is a question for Dr. De Vries. I have a son that is 23, and I know the TAND checklist is more for children, but my son is now in a intermediate care facility. He has been for 3.5 years. His overall behavior, wellness, everything at the home is tremendously positive. When he comes home with us, it's the same as it was before he moved into his home. Would it be beneficial for us and his home to fill out a TAN checklist?
Have I just switched it off? Yeah. Thank you for asking. I'm sure that was a planted question because the answer is the TAN checklist was deliberately made across all ages. So anybody at any age can use it, and that's why we made it. We didn't want to have an infant version and a child version and an adult version because then nobody will use anything. So anyone can use it and use what's appropriate, leave out what's not appropriate. That's the purpose. So definitely I think it'll be helpful for people to bring together different perspectives to try and understand your son's needs. We're always careful not to talk about individual stories, but I will give you a general answer, which is many people with developmental disabilities, etc., particularly when they have intellectual developmental challenges or autism as well, associate particular behaviors with a particular context and different behaviors with a different context. And so it is very common that somebody can be amazing, for instance, in school and very different at home, or really good when visiting granny and very different at home. So we grow up associating different contexts with different kinds of behaviors because we learn very quickly, often with one trial. We were talking to Eva last night about how Papa hearing and saying one thing once, he's got it. So it means the learning is there, but that learning is now paired with perhaps unhelpful information. So the general strategy I think would be really helpful. Look at the two different scenarios and then think perhaps with a team how you can change your context so that it almost becomes a new context for him with new rules and better kinds of behaviors. So very generic response. Feel free to come and chat, but I hope that was useful for the rest of you about the checklist too.
Hi. You know, one of the gifts of being further down this road than some people who are newly diagnosed. My son David was diagnosed 33 years ago. And I used to tell doctors here in Dallas, you guys got this seizure stuff figured out, but the behavioral issues are eating our lunch. And I learned early on to be very careful who I even discussed the behavioral issues with, because I knew, I'm a licensed counselor, I knew there would be possible missed diagnosis and more likely an over-medication or removal from school placements and things like that. There were, so, you know, we had property destruction, aggression in our home out the wazoo, but nobody knew because we couldn't afford to tell anybody, because we knew what the risks were if we let anybody know. It only happened at home most of the time, and people would say, well, it must be a problem with the family. And I would say, no, it's because we're safe. We're the only safe people he can do this with, and he knew we weren't going anywhere. But I just want to say thank you, because what you just did was explain 33 years of our world and our lives with our beloved David in a way that makes perfect sense. I could not have done all that, but I could have told you when you put it up there, I was like, yep, that's it right there. And so for those of you who are newer at this, yay for the work that's been done, and I am eternally grateful for the work you guys have put together to help us manage this much bigger picture of TS than just seizures or tumors in the kidneys or whatever. I just want to say thank you. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. I think that's a really, that's a beautiful and a powerful response. I think you illustrate why it's important, why our philosophy in the TAND research community has been to work with families, because that's the only way we are going to do what you need, right? And I think, so that's number one. I started TSC research 25 years ago now. Don't sing happy birthday. And when I did, there was really a tiny handful of people who were interested and concerned about the behavioral and developmental aspects of TSC. There was a wonderful woman in England called Anne Hunt. Some of you might know Anne. She was really the pioneer in the 20th century of saying, but this is important. Anne was a scientist, but she was also a mum of a son with TSC. So she knew the challenges. And so thank you for the thank you, but I think one thing that's also been very powerful is that the TSC community at large has grown to see and to recognize the importance of TAND. I mean, for those of you who were at the dinner last night, a donation from the Bhatia family for TAND research, in fact, Ann Janssen in Belgium lobbied, and there was the first ever TAND-specific grant call in Europe, and that's what funded the TANDem Project. So I think people have realized, exactly as you say, that many aspects of TSC we have a good sense of, but people like Hope, the experts in other aspects of TAND, of TSC, have also realized that TAND is where the challenge lies now. And so I think it's nice that you thank us as the TAND guys and girls, but I think we also need to thank all the non-TAND people for really supporting the development, the initiatives, etc., including these guys in the TSC Alliance and all of you. So you thank us, and I will, on behalf of all the TAND researchers, thank all our colleagues who are not TAND researchers and workers for their support. That's the only way I think we can do it. And now please ask Hope or Eva a question.
Well, any of you may answer this or respond to it, but I too may want to thank you. I'm not an ingrate, but I do have a couple of questions about language and what it communicates, and its TAND levels is the one that I think you maybe would want to consider, that because it implies hierarchy, as one is over the other or under the other or occurring before the others. Maybe think about, I don't know, morphing that language a little bit. And then the other one, you know, it's just like there was something left off at the end there where you had about, well, we want to have early diagnosis and intervention, and then early diagnosis, identification leading to early intervention, and the, you know, there was a space missing there for the prevention component. And I know it's a reach and I'm asking for a lot, but that's, you know, the future is that we ultimately get to the point where we can suggest such early intervention that it prevents the manifestations from developing into that problem.
Okay, I'll give a quick response and then I'll ask Hope also to give a response. It's good to hear comment about language like levels, and I think for the moment we chose that because those are kind of theoretical levels rather than the natural way these things come together. And we can certainly think about what makes sense. Also, when you translate it to different languages, there's sometimes a problem, Deborah. Prevention is a very interesting concept, and I'm going to not give you a good answer, but I will give you an answer from autism. In the autism, so I do a lot of autism research now, and for decades, people have tried to find biomarkers for autism, for the, you know, so that you can pick it up before it's there or whatever. And in many neurodisabilities, people have tried to look for prevention strategies. Even in TSC, you know, some of the studies have been, like Epistop and others, preventing these kind of difficulties from happening. And at the moment, we don't have very, very strong support that we can prevent many of these challenges. That's just where the research evidence is at. We want to prevent. I understand the philosophy of that, but we're not very good at that. So there's not great scientific evidence for prevention, but there's this glaring gap of people who have difficulties who aren't identified. You know, in TSC, we say that half of people with TSC might have autism. And yet, when we did this, the TOSCA study in Europe, the average age of diagnosis of autism was 7 years, right? So there's a low-hanging fruit for us to say, if your child has some language developmental problems or other kinds of things, let's do something now. Let's not wait for a diagnosis even. Let's think how we can work with that. That's what we mean by early identification and early intervention, because we know that at least there's good evidence for that at the moment. That doesn't preclude continuing to look for prevention kind of things, but we also we want to give people tools now that might help in catching it early. And in fact, in most of mental health, you might be absolutely fine today or next week or next month or next year, but in 2 years' time, something new may emerge, and we might not have been able to prevent that. But then we want to catch it early. Hope, comment on prevention, maybe broader than TAND, et cetera, in TSC.
Thank you for this great opportunity for me to bring to everyone's attention a brand new study that's just started called TSC Steps. It's being led by Dr. Darcy Kruger at Cincinnati, and many places in the United States have sites. And in this study, we are looking at the effect of mTOR inhibitors started very early, like within months of birth, to see if this might have an impact on seizures and also neuropsychiatric function, which I think would include many of your TAND issues. So there's a new study called TSC Steps, aimed specifically at babies, looking at mTOR eyes as a potential intervention that might act as a prevention. So thank you for bringing that up.
But now, I'm going to take that's the advantage when you're sitting on the front, right? This might be my last chance. And it's a question that we're going to talk about in one of our discussion groups, too. There are also many of you, many adults with TSC, or children even with TSC, who have never had epilepsy, who have never had seizures, but you are also at risk of TAND manifestations. So whilst it's really important to evaluate and generate an evidence base for seizure-associated things, there are multiple pathways to TAND in TSC. So don't believe and feel that you can't or shouldn't be having TAND manifestations if you've never had seizures in your life either. Okay, that was my message. They're going to make a stop soon, aren't they, I think?
So can we just have just one last question?
Yes, please, go ahead. Just going to say, like, in terms of prevention, as a person who is 44 and lives a normal life, who is diagnosed young, I think it's very important that we make sure that we give parents both perspectives in the full. Like, my parents were told that I was going to be a vegetable. Obviously, I'm not. I have my master's. My intellectual level is very high, and as far as school goes, academically, I surpassed all of my non-TSC peers. So we have to be very careful when we present the information, that we do so in a way, because these are people. I have a son, he also has TSC, and here we are 40 years later, and I'm having doctors say, oh, you know, but, you know, when he turns 6 months old, this and this and this and this, and all the negative is piled onto him. And as a person with a psych background as well, I can tell you that if you're going to put all that negative energy onto a person and then not expect them to have self-esteem issues, where are you coming from there? Like, you're creating that environment for that person to feel like they can't become something, because all you've done is say they're going to have limitations, and instead of giving it an open mind and saying, let's see how this person develops, this could happen, but this could not happen. And so when we talk about prevention, yes, we don't want this severe situation to happen, but because kids are being diagnosed earlier in utero, etc., because of the technology that we have to remember that you may have diagnosed them as an infant, but they might have a relatively normal life. When I was younger, people weren't necessarily diagnosed later or as early because they didn't have that technology. In fact, they didn't do ultrasounds on pregnant women unless they were having pregnancy difficulties. So, you know, just keep in mind, I guess, the environmental aspects when you're talking about some of this stuff that could be contributing to this as well.
I'm afraid, thank you for that very valid point.
I think it's... Can I have a quick question, please? We talked about mTOR inhibitor to prevent seizure or psychiatric issues. Is there any doctors are doing research how long a person should be on mTOR without significant side effect in the hope preventing some psychiatric, you know, or psychological issues?
We really don't know the answer to your question. It's an excellent question. We do know that people have used mTOR inhibitors for extended periods of time because they've been approved by the FDA since the 1990s for other indications. So we do know that long-term, they are very safe to use. But the answer to your specific question, I really don't think we have that yet, and time is going to tell us as we continue to study it and gather data.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Hope. So with that, we're going to close this session. A big thank you to all our wonderful speakers and to all of you here. Just a quick reminder, definitely fill in the session survey. You can do it on the app, or you can do it the good old way, pencil and paper, and hand it over at the registration desk. The feedback really helps us to improve conferences for the future. Thank you so much.